daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be.
Recording now, so praise the Lord. I'm going to get back to the word. Amen. And call your attention. Amen. The title of tonight's teaching is Hidden in the Cleft of the Rock. I'm going to call your attention just to one portion of scripture, and I'll be reading from a couple of different ones. And it was the one where Moses had asked the Lord to show him his glory. And the Lord said unto him, I'll cause all my goodness to pass before thee, and I will proclaim my name, the name of the Lord before thee. And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show mercy upon whom I will show mercy. And he said, thou canst not see my face, for there shall no man see me and live. Amen. So in other words, the Lord was telling Moses that if you see my face, if you're exposed to my glory, you will die. And then he said, behold, there is a place by me, and thou shalt stand upon a rock. And he said, and it shall come to pass while my glory passeth by, that I will put thee in the cleft of the rock, and I will cover thee with my hand while I pass by. And I will take away my hand, and thou shalt see my back parts, but my face thou shalt not see. And I often, you know, wondered about that, and I just love how I feel like the Lord, you know, just revealed this back parts where he was saying, because there's no shadow of turning when it comes to the Lord. Amen. God the Lord is everywhere. He fills all space. He's all powerful. He's all omnipotent. If we talk about the three ways of God, but there's more ways of God, because he's all wise. You know, I mean, there's so much to God it's past finding out. His knowledge is past finding out. But here it says the back, when it talks about his back, the backside, the rear, the at backward, and then this definition right here is the one that just caused me to kind of understand what he was revealing to Moses, my hereafter of time. So what he was revealing to Moses when he took his hand away was he was revealing another dispensation from the dispensation that Moses was in. See, the dispensation that Moses was in was the dispensation of the law, because Moses had just brought down the law and broke it at the foot of the mountain, because the children of Israel had they had disobeyed the Lord and made a golden calf. And so Moses said, you're not worthy of the law, not worthy of these Ten Commandments, and broke it before them. And God just told them, I'm going to destroy this people. I want them to take off all of their ornaments before me so that I can decide what to do with them. And Moses said, kill 3,000 of them right here and now. Kill the ringleaders. Praise the Lord. So here Moses is talking and interceding for the children of Israel. It was like they just got punished, and Moses is back on the mountaintop talking with the Lord, interceding for them. Because the Lord told Moses, I'll make a people out of you. And Moses said, if I don't go with you, and the people don't go with you, then they'll talk about us. So Moses is interceding before them, and God is saying, I'll be gracious to whom I'll be gracious to. And then he said, but there is a place, Moses, because you want to see you want to get closer to me, Moses. And you really want to be more intimate with me than just a cloud. To where you are right now in this dispensation, you will be destroyed by my glory. He said, but what I'll do is I'll hide you in this pierced rock. That's another definition, a deeper definition for cleft of the rock. I'll hide you in this pierced rock. And then when I take my hand away, you'll see my back parts, or my hereafter, or another dispensation. In other words, the end of the law. And so the subject of tonight is hidden in the cleft of the rock, and basically the rock in and of itself, and how it is a source of provision for the children of Israel. It is a source of shelter for Moses, right? In fact, this very rock is mentioned in the 17th chapter of Exodus, where it says here in the 17th chapter of Exodus, it said, and all the congregation of Israel journeyed from the wilderness of Sin after their journey according to the commandments of the Lord, and pitched at Rephidim. And there was no water for the people to drink. Therefore, the people did chide with Moses and said, give us water that we may drink. And Moses said unto them, why chide ye with me? Wherefore do you tempt the Lord? And the people thirst there for water. And the people murmured against Moses and said, wherefore is this that thou hast brought us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our cattle with thirst? And Moses cried unto the Lord, saying, what shall I do with this people? They be almost ready to stone me. And the Lord said unto Moses, go on before the people, and take with thee the elders of Israel, and thy rod. Therefore thou smotest the river, and take thine hand and go. And behold, I will stand before thee upon the rock in Horeb, and thou shalt smite the rock, and there shall come water out of it, and the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders. Right? So it was a source of drink for them. Even in the midst of them complaining, even in the midst of them murmuring and wanting to stone Moses, they wanted to stone their leader who led them out of bondage, right? And again, here, the same rock is mentioned here in Numbers, the 20th chapter. And it said, then the children of Israel, even the whole congregation, into the desert, came the children of Israel and the whole congregation into the desert of Zin into the first month. And the people abode at Kadesh, and Miriam died there and was buried there. And there was no water for the congregation, and they gathered themselves together against Moses and against Aaron. And the people chode with Moses and spake, saying, would God that we died when our brethren died before the Lord? Why have you brought us brought up the congregation of the Lord into the wilderness, that we and our cattle should die there? And therefore have made us to come up out of Egypt to bring us into this evil place. Is it no place of seed or figs or vines or pomegranate? Neither is there any water to drink. And Moses and Aaron went from the presence of the assembly unto the door of the tabernacle of the congregation, and they fell upon their faces, and the glory of the Lord appeared unto them. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Take the rod, and gather thou the assembly together, thou Aaron, thy brother, and speak unto the rock before their eyes, and it shall give forth his water. And thou shalt bring forth to them water out of the rock, so that thou shalt give the congregation and their beasts to drink. And Moses took the rock before the Lord, as he commanded. And Moses and Aaron gathered the congregation before the rock. And he said unto them, Hear now, ye rebels. must we fetch you water out of this rock? And Moses lifted up his hand, and with his rod, he smote the rock twice. And water came out abundantly, and the congregation drank, and their beasts also. And the Lord spoke unto Moses and to Aaron, because ye delivered me not, because you believed me not, ye sanctified me to sanctify me in the eyes of the children of Israel. Therefore, ye shall not bring this congregation into the land which I have given them. This is the water of Meribah, because the children of Israel strove with the Lord, and he sanctified, and he was sanctified in them. See, Moses wasn't supposed, he just told Moses, speak to the rock, don't strike the rock, just speak to the rock. He already revealed to Moses what this rock was for. See, there was more than just a little bit of revelation knowledge. And so he called this place, amen, this Meribah place, strife and contention. See, where there's envy and strife, there's every evil work. Where there's envy and strife, there's every evil work. That's why you have to guard your heart against all of that. That's why what's happening now in today's time with all of this envy and strife, where folks are prejudiced towards one another, you have to guard your heart against that. People are always going to be like that. And that's why the scripture says in Timothy, evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse. See? So you can't get yourself caught up in that. Get yourself caught up in civil rights and all of that. Because our rights come from the Lord. Our right, all our righteousness is in him. Not in trying to look towards the law, because laws are constantly changing. And it's amazing. Listen, it's more amazing about what Moses was exposed to in Exodus 33. Let me show you something in Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter. It's amazing what he was exposed to, and he knew this too. Paul was talking about this. He said, moreover, brethren, I would not have ye that ye should be ignorant how that our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea. Look, let me read this in the New Living Translation. See, he said, I don't want you to forget, dear brothers and sisters, about our ancestors in the wilderness long ago. All of them were guided by a cloud that moved ahead of them, and all of them walked through the sea on dry ground. In the cloud and in the sea, all of them were baptized as followers of Moses. Isn't that something? In other words, Moses had a baptism, and they were baptized under that doctrinal baptism of Moses, under the law. And all of them ate the same spiritual food. And all of them drank the same spiritual water. For they drank from the spiritual rock, help me, Jesus, that traveled, look, that traveled with them. The rock traveled, that means that rock traveled with them. And Moses, rather than speaking to it, he took what, see, that pierced rock meant something. It represented something. Jesus wasn't going to go. It represented Jesus going to Calvary. In other words, Jesus wasn't going to go to Calvary twice and be punished twice. What he was punished for was our provisions, for our protection, for our covering. And because Moses got mad, he struck it again. And God said, you won't take the people because you let them make you contentious and disrespectful and not sanctify me in their eyes. And so they weren't sanctified by this spiritual water, because it was a spiritual rock that followed them. And that rock was Christ. Glory to God. Upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. See, Moses knew what he was doing, because Moses was hid in the cleft of the rock. See, rock of ages, cleft for me. Let me hide my soul in thee. Glory to God. That's an amazing, amazing song. I love that song. And if you've ever heard the lyrics or listen to the lyrics of this particular song, the lyrics on this are amazing. Glory to God. Rock of ages, cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Rock of ages, cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy rivet side which flow. O be of sin, the doubt cure, cleanse me from its sin and power. Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. Naked come to thee for dress, helpless look to thee for grace. Vile I to thy fountain fly, wash me, Savior, or I die. Rock of ages, cleft for me. Glory to God. Saints of God, hallelujah. He's our rock and he's our salvation. Amen. The Lord is our rock and our salvation. Of whom shall we fear? Glory to God. Hallelujah. Amen. Yet God was not pleased with most of them. And their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. This is Paul talking. These happen as a warning to us so that we should not cleave to evil things as they did, or worship idols as some of them did. As the scriptures say, the people celebrated with feasting and drinking, and they indulged in pagan reveling. And we must not engage in sexual immorality as some of them did, causing 23,000 of them to die in one day. This is amazing, saints. This right here, I want to go back to this scripture right here. This scripture right here, I believe, is in Let me see here. I may have to cross-reference it. I think it's Numbers 25. Yeah, Numbers 25. Let me go back to Numbers 25. I'll open up a new tab. Numbers 25. Now watch this. While the Israelites camped at Acacia Grove, it's also pronounced, or in the Hebrew, it's Shittim. Some of the men defiled themselves by having sexual relations with local Moabite women. These women invited them to attend sacrifices to their gods. So the Israelites feasted with them and worshiped the gods of Moab. And in this, Israel joined in worship to Baal of Peor, causing the Lord's anger to blaze against his people. Now watch what Baal Peor means, or Peor. Lord of the Gap, or Lord of the Cleft. That's basically what it means. Lord of the Cleft. I don't know where I saw that, but that's Lord of the Gap, or Lord of the Cleft. That's what Baal Peor means. Causing the Lord's anger to blaze against them. In other words, they were worshiping another cleft. And the Lord issued the following command to Moses. Now, this is what Paul was talking about in the 13th chapter. While they worshiped other gods and caused 23,000 of them. See, and here it says 24,000. The Lord issued the following command to Moses. Seize all the ringleaders and execute them before the Lord in broad daylight, so his fierce anger will turn against the people, from the people of Israel. And so Moses ordered Israel's judges. These are the leaders. Each of you must put to death the men under your authority who have joined in worshiping Baal of Peor, right? Then one of the Israelite men brought a Midianite woman into his tent right before the eyes of Moses and all the people. So Moses had just killed 1,000 men, 1,000 of the ringleaders, right? And one of the Israelite men brought another woman right in the middle of them, right in the midst to his tent. He couldn't get away from it. And all the people, as everyone was weeping in the entrance of the tabernacle, and when Phinehas, son of Eleazar, the grandson of Aaron, the priest, saw this, he jumped up and left the assembly. He took his spear and rushed after the men in his tent. And Phinehas thrust the spear all the way through the man's body into the woman's stomach. So the plague against the Israelites stopped. But not before 20, see, look, it said 23,000. See, Moses had just killed 1,000 of the ringleaders, right? The plague had already had started on 23,000, but it said not before 24,000 people had died. Then the Lord said to Moses, Phinehas, the son of Eleazar, the grandson of Aaron, the priest, has turned my anger away from the Israelites by being as zealous among them as I was. So I stopped destroying all Israel as I had intended to do so, to do in my zealous anger. And it says, now tell him that I am making my special covenant of peace with him. In this covenant, I give him and his descendants a permanent right of priesthood. Now look, he was of the Levitical priesthood, and he's telling him, I'm giving you a permanent right and your descendants to the priesthood because of what he did. But this is me saying this, and this is my commentary. He's not talking about the Levitical priesthood for his zeal. And for me, his God, he purified the people of Israel, making them right with me. See, that's what he did. Praise the Lord. The Israelite killed with the Midianite woman's name was Zimri. Now, I just want to just kind of identify this too. I don't want to get too far off the subject here. Zimri, his name meant music. See, sometimes you get too caught up in the music ministry and not wanting to do the will of God. So God said, listen, I'm going to put a stop to it. You want to mingle with the world and you want to be worshiping idolatry? This man took a spear and stopped it. And God said, I'm making him a permanent part of the priesthood. And I believe what he's saying to him, I'm making him part of the Melchizedek priesthood. He's representing what Melchizedek represents. Glory to God. I said he's representing what Melchizedek represents. Amen. That's right. Praise God. Because what happened to Jesus? Jesus said, I need you. What I want you to do is I want you to recognize, amen, what happened to me. See, what happened to Jesus? When he told his disciples, I want you to feel the prince in my hands and in my side. Because that's real. It wasn't just a farce. That's how they knew that it was Jesus, that it was him, and not a fake thing was that. They were encouraged when they saw the prince in his hands and the wound in his side. Glory to God. Let me pull it up here. When they saw that, see, that same evening, the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples had assembled for the fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst of them, saying, peace be unto you. And when he had so said, he showed them his hands and his side, and the disciples were glad. Glory to God. See, the disciples were glad. Amen. Hallelujah. I was trying to look for this scripture where it said out of his side where the soldier pierced his side. Amen. Because what came out of his side was significant for us, saints of God. The piercing of what came out of his side, but his body was already dead. Does someone know what that scripture was? Here it is right here. And one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came out blood and water. Glory to God. See? And that was the pierced side, because that is for, amen, our, not only for our justification, but it's for our cleansing. See, we're now drinking of the spiritual water. We're now cleansed by his blood. See, that's why it says in John, I believe it's John, 1 John, uh, Well, let me bring you to this scripture here in Hebrews. Amen. In Hebrews 9 and 19. 9 and 19. It said, when Moses has spoken every precept of all the people according to the law, he took the blood of calves and of goats with water and scarlet wool and hyssop, which is a tree of how you would sprinkle, and sprinkled both the book and all the people, saying, this is the blood of the testament which God hath enjoined you to. Wherefore he sprinkled with blood both the tabernacle, now it was blood and water, the tabernacle and all the vessels of the ministry, and almost all things are by the law purged with blood. And without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. Praise God. And then one more final verse I want to bring to you. And then I'm going to tell you a story. I'm just going to tell you a story. Amen. In John 5 and 6. And this is just a confirmation of what happened in the Old Testament. Praise the Lord. And it says, and when it's talking about Jesus, it says, it is he who overcometh the world, but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God, this is he that came by water and blood, even Christ Jesus, not by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit that beareth witness, because the Spirit is truth. See? And it's that Spirit that bears truth. This is the Spirit. It says, for there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. These three are one. And there are three that bear witness in earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood. These three agree in one. See? And with Moses had to kill a calf, and then they took the water, and then they sprinkled the books, they sprinkled the tabernacle, and they sprinkled the people. That soldier, when he pierced his side with his spear, he was fulfilling what happened in Numbers 25. What's his name? Let me see what his name was again. Phinehas. And when he said he'll be a permanent part of the priesthood, because he pierced and stopped the plague. See? But when that soldier pierced his side, he was confirming what happened when it is finished with Christ at Calvary, what he does for us. See, Moses was just doing a type and shadow of what the blood and the water does. But Jesus, as a part of what the witness is on earth, his Spirit, we have his Holy Ghost, confirmed by the washing of the water of the Word and the blood that's on the mercy seat for us. These three agree in one. See, we're washed by the blood of the Lamb. We're covered by the blood of the Lamb. Our households are covered by the blood of the Lamb. We have his Holy Ghost inside of us. That's why we're baptized in water. Amen. But we're washed by the water, washing of the water of the Word. But it's because of what happened in his pierced side. Amen. Praise the Lord. And we're to hide in the cleft of the rock. See, that rock of ages for us. I was listening, you know, to Ravi Zacharias, and he was talking about Malcolm Muggeridge. He's a brilliant philosopher and writer who was an atheist turned Christian, an orator and writer of famous writings. And he was giving his testimony of how when he was in India, and he had kind of a lustful heart. And one night he decided to go for a swim. And It was nighttime. Off in the distance, he saw a silhouette of a woman who, in India, typically they would wash themselves in the rivers. And he saw a woman, and his conscience was telling him, don't go any further. Don't swim out there. But his lust was overcoming him. So he continued to swim towards her. He continued to swim at this woman. And the closer he got to her, he was getting closer to this woman. And the closer he got to her, the woman saw that someone was coming, and she hid herself. She covered herself because she saw someone was coming. And the closer he got, he was pulling into focus and realized it was a woman that was stricken with leprosy. And she didn't have any nose, and her fingers were all eaten up and off. She didn't have any fingers, and the eyelids were all eaten up. So it was just, her eyes were all bugged out. And he thought to himself, what an ugly sight. And he said, the Lord spoke to him and said, I told you, you thought it was your conscience, but I told you not to go any further. And he was telling him that it's not the ugliness of the woman, it's the ugliness of your heart. And he brought out the scripture in Jeremiah 17:9, where it says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? And then that's the question that Jeremiah brought out. And God immediately answers and says, I, the Lord, search the heart, and I try the reins, even to give every man according to his way and according to the fruit of his doing. In other words, he's the one that allowed the spear to go through his side so that we can hide in the cleft of the rock. Because he was the one that was wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities, and the chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we're healed, we're set free, and we're delivered, because he is the rock of ages. Cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Amen. And as we close, I appreciate this song. And so if y'all would just, amen, be all right with me playing this song by Amy Grant and Vince Gill. Amen.
Thank you.
I'm glad for the Lord, because if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, then our enemies would have swallowed us up. You know, we would have been swallowed up in our own lust and our own shame and our own sickness and our own self-pity, or else, you know, our own hatred, whatever it is. But Jesus came to deliver us and to save us, for us to be hidden in the rock, in the cleft of the rock. Amen. And so I'm so thankful for Jesus, thankful for the blood and the water, thankful for his spirit. Amen. And that he has called us to be priests. Amen. And so I'm so thankful for Jesus and thankful for you all in the Bible study that we have. Amen. Just continue to pray for us, because we want to continue to minister the word. Thank you all for your giving, for your all participation. I want you to know that God sees what you're doing, and don't be discouraged by the delay if things don't be going the way you know, and as fast as they should be going for you. Just know that you've been hidden in the cleft of the rock, and that he's not allowing you to be destroyed, but he's covering you and he's protecting you and he's providing for you. And you are being spiritually nourished and fed, amen, by that rock. And that rock is following you. Even as it was following the children of Israel, it's following us. But Jesus said, upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So my admonishment to you is to be hidden in the rock, in Jesus' name. Let's have a word of closing prayer, unless anyone has any comments. All right. Well, let's have a closing word of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord God, that we can be hidden in the cleft of the rock, O God. And that rock is Jesus, O God. We thank you, Lord God, for blessing us, O God, to hear your word, and asking, O God, that you would continue to allow your word to give us understanding, to give us a rest assurance, O God, that everything is going to be all right, O God, and that you have everything under control, and that you're working all things, as your word says in Romans 8 and 28, O God, all things, we know that all things work together for the good to them that love the Lord and are the called according to your purpose. And so we just trust in you, O God, and asking that you would continue to bless us, O God, continue to bless every household, O God, in the name of Jesus. The Lord bless thee, the Lord keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. Lord, you said you'd put your name upon the children of Israel and bless them forever. Save us and we shall be saved. Heal us and we shall be healed, for thou art our praise, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. Until we meet again, we give your name praise and glory and honor. Amen and amen. God bless you all. We love you all, and we'll see you on Sunday. Oh, let me just make this an announcement, too, while I'm talking.
Daily walking close to thee, let it be, dear Lord, let it be.